I would like to begin my talk by stating that I would be talking about minimalism, conscious consumerism, and then relating it to furniture. And so this, my talk is basically to invigorate a mindset for adequacy with a certain relation to furniture, but then it is a mindset for adequacy in everything that we do. So yeah, now I would like to begin by stating the facts first. So I would like to begin by showing you a basic journey of how we have evolved so far. So we, as in, I'm talking about the whole universe and all the living beings that are there in our world, and we have begun by, as my friend Gyandeep also said earlier, that we begin by the collision of stars and the explosions, and then we are at the position that we are right now. And we are seeing lots of different things happening and evolving into. So first the world began, then the world was in a perfect symbiosis. Then we as humans developed into our current states. And then there was this time when we stopped caring about our natural resources. And then we could see that we just, the evolution graph just took off, and we are seeing basically the effects of damages everywhere. Now, due to this, there is a very stark contrast that has been divided, and we are basically, our population is living on the same planet, but it's essentially on different worlds. So the 50% of the poorest population that we have, that we can see, you know, representative on the left side, just contributes 7% to the global, you know, emissions, and the 7% of the population, which is the richest population in the world, the 7% of that contribute a whole 50% of the greenhouse gas emissions. So this is the contrast that we're living in. This is what we have evolved into. And as we have just passed the you know, Black Friday and Cyber Monday sales that we have all over the world now, and I would like to just show this you know, direct correlation between what I'm talking about. So November and December is a time when Black Friday, Cyber Monday, Christmas and New Year sales happen all around the world. And January and February is the peak demand time for the self-storage industry in not only the US, but Europe, and also coming up in countries like China and Japan. And so there we have established a direct correlation between the need to buy stuff and the need to store then the extra stuff that we have. So conscious consumerism, like what do we mean by it? Let's have a few tips from Brad Pitt. Yeah. So I included these stuff because this is a part of our consumer culture. This is a part of what we all can relate to. Rather than me talking about, if we see someone talk about that, then we could, you know, relate much better. So here we can also see that the so yeah, I'll let you understand from the subtitles because the audio is not working. So yeah, I would like to, you know, pause here, and then I would like to just tell what was happening in that. So a person was telling him that I have all the things that we can imagine. I have a very expensive closet of clothes. I have a very expensive furniture. I have all the things that I need, and then what else should I do? So he tells you, so Brad Pitt then asks him that, do you know what a really expensive type of a blanket is? So he knows that, and he tells him that this is something that is wrong with us. That we know things that are not of really value to us, but then we know and consume those because we are, as he says, that a product of a lifestyle obsession that we are not consuming consciously, and that is why we are just holding on to things. So I would like to just state this very clearly that whatever we buy has a very, you know, correlations to all the aspects that we don't explicitly see, but that are then implicitly related to it. We have social aspects, environmental aspects, it's costs that we are incurring, and the costs can also be, you know, psychological cost as well as financial cost, the health that it is affecting, the health effects that it is incurring onto us. and you know the ethical nature of the how the products are being made and then being sold. So all of this leads us to the definition of minimalism that I want to talk about. That is, it relates to focusing on what really adds value. It doesn't relate to what doesn't matter and then just holding stuff. It relates to what really adds value, and this is what the whole complete definition of minimalism is. Now, how do we relate it to furniture? So let's just understand what the new trend in the furniture is. So the newest trend in the furniture is very much relatable to what we have in the food industry and in the apparel industry. That is the fast furniture. So what is fast furniture? And IKEA is the, you know, the representation of that. It started the trend and it is the stalwart of that. What is it? That it uses cheap resources. It uses innovative ways to minimize cost in shipping. And then it reduces the overall cost of a product so that you can replicate it multiple times and sell it at a very cheap price to as many consumers as you can. This sounds, and this doesn't sound wrong, and it in principle isn't wrong, but the things start getting wrong when there is a high, you know, humanitarian and the environmental costs associated to it. So as we can see that if you trace all the connections to it that I was talking about, a simple table that we buy at an IKEA store for 4,000 rupees and which has a low upfront cost to us, but then is incurring a very high environmental cost and a very high humanitarian cost in countries and places which you can't see there and then when buying the table. So this is something that we need to inculcate into ourselves. So this is a sort of, now I'd like to present you the, you know, contrast that is there in the definition of minimalism related to it. So there is a sort of visual trend that is catching up in millennials of visual minimalism, which we can see represented by the figure on the right. But there is also the exact, you know, the more realistic definition of minimalism that we want to, that we should focus on, and which reduces the impact of resources, the requirements of spaces, and the, you know, the time that a certain material takes to produce, takes to process, and then takes to be in the final shape and form that we buy it. So this is another sort of, this is the actual sort of minimalism that we should strive to be. Now I can show you just quickly in some seconds, I can show you some examples of how people and designers have reacted to it and made up minimalist furniture. So this furniture set that we are seeing is not only visually, you know, minimal, but also uses a material called EcoFoam, which is derived from all the sustainably sourced and very ecological, and has as much as 90% of the recycled content in its manufacturing. It is also low VOC. Other than that, we have materials coming up like paper yarn, which are being developed in countries like countries like Netherlands and all. And what it does is that it can be used as a fiber, and it can be worn onto carpets. It can be made into stools and chairs and curtains. So other in countries like China, where there is a lot of ceramic waste from the industry, some designers have worked on to how to include that into furniture, and they have casted out stools and tables from it using all of the using just 100% ceramic waste from the industries as a byproduct. So here we can see that you know, we can also develop some basic sort of furniture at home also. We can see these planters and these, you know, stools made from newspapers in different forms. So these are very low cost options, which doesn't require any kind of resources, and which can contribute to a global sense of conservation and minimalism, not only related to visual appeal, but also to resources, to time, and to our effects on our health and all. So this is what I was willing to share with you on this topic. So thank you for the talk, and thank you for letting me speak on this topic. So yeah.